everybody. I was chewing a chip in time to the music. How's the sound? Can people hear me okay? Hey, everybody. Bonnie and NDH and Dana, I saw you come in. It's so good to see you. Yeah, I mean, it's 7:07. It's not 7:10. Usually I try to come in right at 10 minutes past the hour, but it's as though changes. Hey, kitty. Changes are afoot. Mm. Perhaps awesome changes. Perhaps changes that will benefit all of us. I'll get into that. I'll get into it. It's good, DeMarie. That's great. So usually, I mean, I don't want to spring things on people. Usually, you know, I come in at 10 past. So I'm not going to like launch into anything just yet because that's not fair. But I've been thinking. I've been thinking about the show. I mean, the couple days that I had off, I mean, Saturday night, I was kind of like, I have to take a night off. And then Tuesday, you know, we planned things. It was a revelation. It was a revelation. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit tonight and share with you some wonderful things. They're wonderful things. They're wonderful things. What I can do now, for sure, before I get into the quilt. That's right, the quilt behind me. The very, very famous quilt behind me. That's the intro quilt for the show. We're not waiting. It's one of the things that's going to happen. I'm going to come in, and I'm just going to quilt bomb you. I know I'm kind of like jumping around, but I'm so excited. I'm so excited, everybody, because, you know, for the first time in a while, I see like the path before me, you know, and it's exciting in terms of the show, the Quilt Nerd Show. And so I'm going cinnamon and sugar. I love it, Susan. It's so true. The cinnamon and sugar intro quilt. Yeah, I feel like if some of you have seen this, I know some of you are aware of this quilt, but I mean, after, hey, Hootsie, we have a champagne cork sound. After tonight, you will be initiated into the group of people in the world, the group of quilt nerd people who know this quilt called Crazy City. And then you know you're a real quilt nerd because, you know, Crazy City is like a canonical quilt in the quilt canon. Anyway, I was thinking about changes and things and, I see the path before me and I love this show so much and you know it. And I want to see it grow and bloom like a flower. And so having a few days off was like, I felt like that guy on the motorcycle out there, probably. I felt really good, and I got a lot of thinking done, and I looked at a lot of feedback from you all, and I got honest with Eric about life and some very exciting, exciting things. It's a motorcycle out there in the back. I mean, on the street. One of the things that is on the docket equipment-wise when that can happen is this mic that will help that not happen. Anyway, so I have some things to share with you about that. But the thing that's different tonight, other than the I came in a little bit before 7:10 to get things warmed up, is that we're gonna jump into this quilt, and then I'm gonna talk about some other stuff. Because one of the suggestions from you all, I'm sorry, I've had days to like build up to this moment where I'm talking to you, so I'm like, I hope that's okay. SJ Pepper, oh, thank God you're here. My lighting and makeup are good tonight. Thank you. It's like taking me a minute, you know, but I've had days to like, so I'm like burbling with excitement to tell you things because I've had these days to build up to this moment. And so thanks for just kind of sticking with me. There's so much to share. And Hootsie received a call from AQSG. You missed several lives this past week, but the discount code did not work. What? Interesting. AQSG. crack whip. No. But no, that's good to know, Hootsie. Okay, it's in my notes. So I wanna just do a little quilt extravaganza first, because one of the suggestions that a loyal viewer had was that, you know, if people stop by this show when it starts, and the quilt the goods don't come until later, because we're having fun and we're chatting and it's great and it's conviviality is what I would call it. You know, maybe they're like, there's a lot of fun happening in this room, but where are the quilts? Show me the quilts. So maybe that's something I'm gonna do. And there's other pieces to this, but let's talk about this quilt. And you know what? So in Karen, hey Karen, the AQSG code lasts through the end of June. You get $15 off your membership for American Quilt Study Group, a $75 membership for $60, which is a lot. And they don't do that for anybody else. They've never done a coupon code. So Quilt Nerd 15 gets you an AQSG membership for less for a whole year. I can talk more about that, but right now I'm gonna tempt you. I'm going to tempt anybody, everybody, with the content on this show by showing you the quilt that's behind me. Because on this show, we talk about quilts and we, you know, we goof off. But it's centered on this learning, this quilt learning. So I'm going to get small and I'm going to share this with you. And then we can talk about a few other things. This is like one of the most famous quilts ever. I mean, like, you know, in the United States, I would say, hey, Molly, yay. I'm so glad you're here. So, hey, Bip, and Tawny is here, and Susan. See, it's different, you know, this is a different rhythm for me. So, okay. Prairie Susie from France. Wait a minute. Prairie Susie's from France. You have jet lag and you're up at 2 a.m. However long you last, we salute you. And you're up at least to see this quilt, which is very cool. Hey, Word and Bernard. Bonnie, the other Bonnie. So this quilt was in the Fabric of a Nation exhibit at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, or the Museum of Fine Arts Boston, last year. And into 2022, I believe. I know it was there in 2021. I forget when exactly the exhibit closed. I know I couldn't see it because of Omicron. And hey, Sonia and Fyandor. And this was hanging there. And then in the book, if you all have the Fabric of a Nation book, which I have, and we looked at together, it was back in London. We looked at that beautiful book produced by the museum about the exhibit, the Bisa Butler quilt on the cover. There's another quilt in there. Remember that? Now, the reason I don't have that book with me is because it's on the slow boat. Eric and I shipped the things that we had in London, like heavy books. We shipped them home using like seven seas shipping. So the things that we put on the shipping container, which only got loaded up like this week, really, it will be July when we get our items, but that's okay because it didn't cost an arm and a leg to do that. So my Fabric of a Nation book is on that boat. So I don't have that book right now, but I believe, and if any of you have that at home, and I'm pretty sure you do because you're very nerdy. Padma, did I say hi to you yet? Hello. All right. So in that book, I believe they talk about another quilt that is similar to this one. I'm not making that up, right? Hey, Linda ARP. Hola, indeed. Yes, Susan. Yes. Going to crazy town, crazy city. Exactly. There's a quilt at the Art Institute, I believe. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. Oh, Susan. Just... let's get close to this quilt as I talk about it. There's another quilt that is made perhaps by the same maker. We don't know, I think, but it's very similar. I distinctly remember this, and I saw the other quilt, you know, on a page In a book. And I'm sure it was that one. And it's really remarkable how similar they are. So when that book arrives from London in July via China, I think by way of China, I will confirm all this. But hey, Crosley, you know, Crosley at home says I would love a day show sometime. It's 5 Pacific time, which is about when hubby is done working and expects me to be around. Enjoy to reply today, though. You know what? Yeah. Information on the way. So let's zoom in on this quilt. And I'll tell you what I know about it. Okay. And I'll also tell you why this is even here, this particular day. On Friday, we were looking at Quilters Newsletter Magazine. We were looking at the April 1986 issue of Quilters Newsletter. And this image came up. Talking about an article or a pattern involving houses, of course. And there was this illustration down there. And I was like, whoa, I know that. I know that motif. I know those houses. I know those beautiful eaves, you know, under the eaves on the house. It's so distinctive. It's so specific. And I said to you all, that is from a very famous quilt called Crazy City, and I will show it to you. And so that's what I'm going to do. That's what we're doing. This was in the magazine that we looked at and kind of goes to show just how iconic this particular quilt is. Okay. Whoop. So let me go to the image I was showing you, kind of the flat shot of this quilt, and then I'll show you a few other things, some detail shots too that are really wonderful. So replay Crosley. You know what? I did a lot of replying today too, so... It might have been a reply as well. Anyway. So let's take a look. We have a quilt with a lot of quilt blocks. Okay. We have a quilt with applique. So we have quilt blocks all around the edge. We have the center piece. I mean, what's interesting is like when we look at traditional quilts. A lot of times they fall into these categories of frame quilts or medallion quilts, applique, you know, pieced or applique, you know, it's really broad category. But what's interesting about this particular quilt is that I don't know how it's going to be categorized because it's got a frame around it. I mean, you have these borders. Hey, Kelly Narr, thanks for subscribing. Thanks for being at Quilt Church. I appreciate you very much. And thank you for subscribing for 5 months. I appreciate it a lot. And to all my subscribers, I appreciate you. So there's somewhat of a frame, but the frame is broken. Okay, the frame is broken sort of up at this top here. And by the way, like this frame or this you know, swath of fabric right here. Sorry, let me come down. I could hide. Let me just hide the chat for just a second. Okay, since this quilt is so very, very. Sorry, I just turned the mic down a little bit. I was getting into the red and I don't like that. I think that's okay. Let me know if it's not. Okay. So this quilt is so complex. I'm going to hide the chat for just a minute while we look at it because it's you know what it is. It's crazy. Okay, so we have this semi-frame that sort of swoops down. And then we'll get to the letters and the name. And then we have like this medallion, I guess. I mean, there's a central point of focus to the quilt, but it's not a shape. It's a crazy quilt section. And that is very strange. So Little Bird Stitch, hello. Medallion style, kind of, right? So we have to really zoom out to be able to see these houses. I mean, if you're this close, like you don't necessarily know what's happening, you know, like you really have to step back and look at this to see. And I'm going to spin it to the side so you can see these houses. I mean, isn't this amazing? It's amazing. Now, my mom saw this quilt I remember her telling me this. She saw that, Mom, if you're here, definitely like weigh in and say hi. I don't think you will be, but anyway, saw this quilt change hands. I remember you saying that because there's two quilts that are really, that I remember before I was even interested in quilt history, when I was just like, I want to make lots of quilts before I even cared. Which by the way, gives me a lot of like understanding and compassion for people who are just beginning quilting and don't really care about the history yet. I mean, they don't not care, but they just don't, it doesn't matter to them as much. I was completely that person for a long time. So when I was that person, I still remember a few things. Like I remember names, you know, Mom would mention Penny McMorris or Pauline Burbage or Questa Benberry or these different people. And I retained those names. And I also remember her talking about Crazy City, this quilt. And I remember her talking about the Reconciliation quilt, the quilt that was, that cost the most ever, I believe. It was like $250,000 or something for the International Quilt Museum, or anyway, it was the most expensive quilt that was purchased at auction, I should put it that way. And this one, I remember her saying she remembered it changing hands and that it was like a very big deal. It was either at a show or an auction or something. Now, my mom doesn't collect quilts, and so she must have just been like, you know, hanging out in the VIP room or something like that because she told me that. Mom, if you are in the chat and I'm wrong, tell me later and I will correct in the errata part of my website. But I remember you saying that. So anyway, so what's going on with these letters? What's happening? So it's a big deal quilt, okay? And these letters, so we've seen a lot of this. We see a lot of it where the ends are reversed. Now, I suspect, yeah, Kelly, yes. And that's not this quilt necessarily. That was the Reconciliation quilt, which we've looked at. We haven't looked at specifically on the show, but I talked about it a few times and talked about it on the Quilt Folk block of the month. But we'll look at it at some point. It's a very important quilt. And anyway, you know, if anybody has done a paper or a study on why ends are reversed in applique quilts so often in the past, it will be someone who belongs to the American Quilt Study Group. And I hope many of us will belong to that group because that's where the OG quilt nerds really hang out. And if you want to write something about any of the things we see on the show, you want to dig in, want to know more, all of you are capable of producing research and thoughts on this stuff. So I don't know. Yeah, the Reconciliation quilt, exactly. It'll come up a ton, Kelly. Like it will just continue to come up in our lives. So Susan R. Michael said, if your quilt turns out short, just add some mini quilt block samplers. 1,000%. So hey, Jill, wait a minute, hold on, stop everything. Jill has the best news. I just gave my notice at my job I've been at for 17 long ass years. What? That's amazing. That's so cool. I mean, that's amazing. I'm pushing all the buttons. Congratulations. I think that worked pretty well, actually. That's a huge change. We're proud of you. We're excited for you. It's probably scary. You probably feel like you want to barf and party. You know, like, amazing. You came to the right place. Let's hang out, you know? Let's just hang out. And you can be like, I know who I am. I know what I love. This is a big change in my life, but I made it happen. And now, I don't know. What's next, you know? I hope that was the right response. Anyway, congratulations. That's awesome. Awesome. Ivy Kadivy, thank you so much for subscribing. That's awesome. Kenny, hello. So back to these ends. We will see this again. I don't know much about it. I wish I could tell you. Charles is here. You're not late. You're right on time. So anyway, I did an applique quilt once that had an N in it while I was practicing letters, and I got it backwards, and it was not on purpose. I feel like some of these quilts must have been on purpose. It just kept happening. So it says C. Winnie, okay, as we were looking at, and then Crazy City, 1885. there are these flags that we were looking at before. And here's what we know about this quilt, okay? This is what the Fabric of a Nation exhibit exhibit label said about this quilt. I'm going to turn it to the side again because a few people just came in and I want you to see these extraordinary, beautiful houses that are on either side of this central point of focus, this crazy quilt section. That, by the way, I mean, is very different, right? It's very, very different from the rest of the quilt. The rest of the quilt is blocks and borders and frames, and it's like not the same. Super weird. Jill Alex, please be a quilt dealer and show us all of your stuff before you put it on the market. Not because we can afford it, but we want to talk about it. And Nunmaker, hey, I love this. It's so good to see everybody. Oh my God, I missed you. So, Crazy City from the Fabric of a Nation exhibit label. While the identity of C. Winnie is unknown, and I think it is Winnie, that's what my mom has said, so it might be Win, but I think it's Winnie. I don't know. She knows, she said that, so that's what I say. Crazy City is one of the most striking and unique examples of quilt making from the 19th century. The maker of this quilt enlivened the rows of buildings with applique door handles. Wow. Front steps. Let me get to the ones that are right side up for you. Okay. Applique door handles, front steps, picket fencing, as well as quilting stitches delineating casement windows. Hello. Clapboard siding, roof shingles. Oh, wow. And chimney masonry. I didn't even notice that. Look at that. Holy cow. Rhythmically arranged borders, oh, I like that, are filled with traditional pieced patterns such as flying geese, pinwheel, tumbling blocks, and nine patch, made in mutant. That's hilarious. Made in muted cotton floral prints that were popular in the mid-1800s. The pattern cloth in the central section, okay, the pattern cloth in the central section. Yeah, you know what? Exactly. SJ Pepper. Exactly. They did call it crazy when I was in London. This, I mean, it kind of looks like London, but it's American. Anyway. So yes. Okay. So the pattern cloth in the central section is distinct from the fabrics used throughout the quilt, suggesting it was made separately. You know? So I think, oh, Jill, go to seminar. Oh my God. I think, and many people think, that this crazy quilt central piece was made separately. Like it was a UFO. That's what people have said, that it was a completely different project and that she put it in there for reasons that we don't know, but that we love her for, you know? It's a different quilt. That's kind of like the consensus is that, well, we don't know. Maybe she was like, I'm going to put a portion of a crazy quilt in my quilt. Or like, we could take a poll actually, it'd be really fun. You know, why did she, I wasn't prepared for that, but maybe I could do it. I mean, yes, Word and Bird Nerd, we do usually see crazy quilts made with more fancy fabric. So was she doing like a test run? I could do a poll, you know, like, why do you think, I could do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to put up a poll because I have a couple announcements that I could go into. And, hang on. And I'd like to do a poll, and I can put the poll up while all that is happening. Hang on one second. I'm going to put a poll together and we're going to see what you all think, like what her reasoning was for putting that central crazy quilt portion in there. Okay, why did C. Winnie put in the crazy patch? Was it she was covering up something? She was covering something. I'm limited. Okay. Wait, hiding mistake. I have to be really brief. That's good. Hiding mistake. using UFO. She was crazy, bored, or the fifth option would be, she didn't do it. Someone else did. I mean, it's possible. Okay. So I'm going to put this poll up for 10 minutes. It's the longest I can put up a poll, and I'm going to put it up right now. And I just put it up. So at the top of the chat, you can take the poll. Oh, that was pretty slick there. Pretty slick. And that allows her to name it Crazy City. You know what? Worden Bird Nerd has a very good point. By the way, Worden Bird Nerd, thank you for so much. And it's interesting because, you know, it's like if it was made, maybe that knocks out the last option. Because if someone else, I mean, she must have done it, right? That's an actual siren from the street. It's not me doing it because SJ Pepper said something cheeky, but it counts. Might as well be. So, you know, if she didn't put it in there herself, you know, why would she put Crazy City on her quilt? I mean, they obviously have a relationship, don't they? The centerpiece and the words Crazy City. I mean, I've never seen the word crazy on a quilt. It's so cool. It's so different. Let me turn it around so you can appreciate it from this view. Oh yeah, and I have a couple other views of the quilt. Okay, so let me just show you. And these come from. Hang on. There's a blog, Gladdy. Mm-hmm. Gladdy Porsche. I will put the link in the chat. So you can check her out. But she went to the Fabric of a Nation exhibit and she took some really nice pictures that were on her blog. And so I really appreciate her. And I have just a couple of those detail shots for you. GladdyQuilts.wordpress.com. So visit her blog and check her out and follow her on Instagram and all that stuff. So this is the actual quilt, okay? And she's got some, and then this is another flat shot I got from the internet that isn't as good. But look, so we've got some cool details. I'll go back to this one, but I want to show you this one. Look at that. Isn't that great? Thank you so much, Gladdy, because you're great. Gamer Granny, oh, have two words ever looked more awesome together? I don't think so. That's a champagne cork. She just wanted to get it finished and ran out of ideas. Hootsie, I mean, we all have been there. Could be a repair, says Kenny. Hi, Kenny. I agree. It's very possible. Read your guest, Threadist, what did you say? And first time chat from a viewer, Granny, by the way, welcome basket for you, Gamer Granny. That's so great. I'm so glad you're here. Wait a minute, what did Threadist say? Threadist is wise person indeed. Hang on. Where did it go? Oh, well, Bonnie, sorry. Okay, Bonnie said maybe she tied... I've got that highlighted chat. Sorry, I was putting the thing together and I lost it all. Hang on. Bonnie says. Bonnie, where are you? Hold on. You highlighted your chat. I'm gonna find it. Everything's gonna be fine. Hey, Saucy Stitcher is new too. The chat's going crazy. I gotta. Hang on one second. We have all the time in the world, really. So once you kind of like go into the back catalog of a chat, it's kind of crazy. Okay. Threadist's guests. I guess I just found your, okay. Threadist says, if you look at the crazy quilt part with the flags right side up, it has a roof. Okay. Hang on. Let me just turn this around. So we'll go back to that. Wait, what? Well, I don't like that. Okay, that's fine. If you look at the crazy quilt part with the flags right side up, it has a roof, like that is a house with craziness inside. Oh, that's good. That's very, very good. Moonshine, SJ Pepper. Mm-hmm. Perhaps she was getting crazy with the moonshine. Charles says, I think it's just a park in the courtyard between the houses. Oh, these are Great guesses. Robin's Nest says, I wonder if it's meant to be a central area for this neighborhood, like a park or something. Oh God, I love what you're saying, everybody. Maybe she changed her mind, Kenny says. She started making her crazy quilt and decided she didn't have enough scraps or she just had inspiration. Susan or Michael says she might have spilled some wine and had to conceal it. That's what I think. I mean, it happens to the best of us. Okay, and okay, let's, oh yeah, that's for later. Let's take a look at the big part. Okay. So, oh, interesting. I see what you're saying, Threadis. Gamer Granny and Saucy, I'm so glad that you're in the chat. You're very welcome here. I think you're gonna like it. Molly Squared, I need structure. Ivy Kadivy, maybe she tried the crazy quilt concept in the center and then realized there were so many other options that would be so much more fantastic and fun to do. Yeah. Hold on, let me get to the full. Oh, that's a nice. Actually, let's look at the full thing. Okay. Yeah, I like that. Okay, Caitlin, hey. So yeah, so we've got lots of thoughts about this. And I think everybody, is kind of in agreement that like we don't know. But Molly quotes her, perhaps, I cannot make a whole quilt out of this. I mean, a crazy quilt, I don't know. I feel like people were really, really, really into it. And it was a fad. It was kind of like a Chia Pet or, a Pet Rock or whatever. And maybe there was a burnout, maybe people got to a burnout moment on it because there just were so many. I mean, looking at these old photographs of people in their quilts from the 1880s, or just people in the 1880s that have quilts in the photograph. I mean, there's just picture after picture of crazy quilt pillows, crazy quilt clothes, crazy quilt tablecloths, And so maybe she was like, no, no more. And then maybe that's what made her change her mind. So anyway, so we don't know, but we like it. Horrid little Spitfire, it's so good to see you. Something in that location or plan for that location made her really angry. So let's see what the poll is saying. Right now, 57% of people are saying that she was using a UFO. She was getting a UFO in there, trying to make it work for Lord's sake. For Lord's sake. Okay. There are a few more minutes in the poll. She didn't do it. Some people said she was bored. She was crazy. S.J. Pepper, is that you? One person said she was crazy. So yeah, it probably was considered very modern. So if you came in, the reason we are even looking at this, well, aside from it being an American icon of a quilt, this image was in the Quilters Newsletter magazine that we were reading on Friday. And of course, it is a reference to Crazy City. And so now you all know about Crazy City and that quilt, and yeah, and that's what we've got. Now, I'm gonna move on because I have many things to tell you, but also, oh, Susan says maybe the crazy patch was her first quilt. Ooh, that's good. That's good. Kelly, maybe the maker thought it would be cool to try something from across the pond that was popular at the time, but realized that we Brexited for a reason. Oh! No, not that. So, yes, very good. Okay, I'm gonna end the poll. I'm ending the poll. I think people have voted. I think the people have spoken. She was using a UFO. Half of you said that that's what she was doing. And like what I want Quilt Nerd to be for all of you at all times is a place for inspiration. Do you have a UFO that you can incorporate into something else? You should do it. You should do it. Okay. This is very brief. This is very quick. Many of you, oh, I'm wearing red. I should have had something. It's better contrast, but that's okay. It's too matchy-matchy for my taste, but that's all right. So some of you will remember this quilt. I showed it once and I didn't have a very good picture of it. And then I found a good picture of it. And then I found like another good picture of it because it too is a quilt that really gets around. And this quilt, I mean, if you hadn't seen it before, welcome to one of my favorite quilts that's ever been made. I love this quilt too, Quilting Politic. And a flex. This quilt feels like a flex too. So this is called the Teaching Quilt, and it was made by Elizabeth Hamilton. And she passed in 1950, Elizabeth Hamilton did. She made this in New York around 1934. Okay. She, and in fact, I'm going to disappear. That's right, to disappear. Okay. Because this quilt also has amazing stuff. Yeah, a quilt that gets around. Exactly. It's got some loose threads, if you know what I mean. So, Gamer Granny says, I have pieces of quilts my mom started that I have to finish for my nieces and nephews. Gamer Granny, maybe they're not one and done. Maybe they're parts of another quilt. You know, maybe there's an adaptation that they want to be a part of, you know? I mean, maybe they're a portion of another quilt, maybe they're a combination. Not all of them together. I mean, maybe you've got something else that you're working on that in fact would be wonderful to use with one of those pieces that need a home. You know what I'm saying? This quilt is freaking amazing. Thank you, Saucy Stitcher. I agree. So, Elizabeth Hamilton, red cotton pictures and letters, hand appliqued on a white cotton sheet. Where's Waldo? Exactly. Collection of Ruth G. Strong, photo courtesy of the American Folk Art Museum. Ruth Strong writes, "The teaching quilt was designed by Elizabeth Hamilton, a cousin, for me to play on as a child and learn my letters, numbers, and shapes. The initial G on the jugs is for my maiden name, S.J. Pepper, don't say anything. Gruechow, Gruescow." Cousin Lizzie, as she was reverently called, I'm going to zoom in on some of these wonderful objects here, was in her 60s when she made the quilt. She, is it all turned? I think so. I don't know. She lived near the bay in Patchogue, Patchogue. Someone out there knows how to pronounce that, not me. Interesting, interesting. Long Island, and she was a very artistic maiden lady. Maiden lady, a spunky lady. Her mode. So I'm still quoting from Ruth here, her cousin who received this quilt. A spunky lady. Her mode of transportation was a bicycle. I remember her spending Christmas at our home. She would recite a Christmas carol faithfully for us. Oh my God, I love her. And this quilt was always placed around the base of our Christmas tree. After I married and had children, I continued this tradition, as I'm sure my daughter will do also. I know it's bonkers, right? So I love it very, very much. And let's just zoom out so we can see what it says. It says fox, man, dog, bear, cat, pig, dog, cow, lamb. I mean, it's just all of these letters. Well, so I'm looking through this, which is, let me get my face back in here now. Hang on. No. Oh, yeah, and the chat needs to come back. Oh, good heavens. Okay. So I'm looking through this thing, the Clarion. We've looked at this before. It's the America's Folk Art Magazine, which was produced for some time. I don't think it is still. But I need to check from the Museum of American Folk Art, and this was published in spring 1989. Well, I'm looking through it because, you know. And look what I find. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this. Interesting. Interesting, don't you think? Don't you think that's interesting? Think it's interesting. I think it looks like the same person made that. Now, I could be thinking that, you know, we're all real special for discovering this, for being this detective, doing this detective work. But maybe, you know, it's known. The thing is, if it was known that Elizabeth Hamilton, Lizzie, made this, it would say that. And you know what's interesting too? What's interesting too is that it says Massachusetts summer quilt. Well, first of all, it's New England. So she was in New York, she was in Long Island, Massachusetts, a hop, skip, and a jump. But this quilt that we know and love okay, is stitched on a sheet. So it's not quilted. So this is a summer quilt, which means if you have a summer weight quilt or a summer quilt, there's no batting in it. It's either two layers stitched together without a batting or what, yeah, that's probably what it would be. So, I mean, sorry. Let me look at those shapes. It's totally her. It's red and white. It's totally her. I mean, come on. And the whimsy going on, look, paddles like badminton or ping pong, well, probably like badminton paddles, you know? I mean, or I guess maybe those could be jugs or something, but I mean, it's like completely the same hand, don't you think? You think the first was a study for the second? Interesting. Yep. Okay, because look, there's a paddle. Or maybe those were one of, maybe that was the jug. I was reading and I wasn't looking at the quilt, so I'll have to look at that again. But you know, this little looks kind of like a, yeah, like a paddle. It's the same thing. It's the same thing, you know? So I thought that was pretty exciting. You think she saw this quilt? Hey, Dana, you love the horses? Yeah, me too. I love everything. Okay, so that's what I wanted to share. 1989, Clarion Folk Art Magazine, Mount Vernon Antique Shop. Who knows? Who knows? It was exhibiting at the Great American Quilt Festival. If you are a Mary Kay Waldvogel type person, quilt scholar who is also a detective, if you are just interested, maybe you haven't even chatted because you are so taken with this quilt, you can't move. You're like, and maybe you want to find out what's going on here. There's a lot of information. You could start digging, and then you could write about it for AQSG. Interesting. Okay, so now we are going to go into the main part of the show. And the dates don't line up. Damn, Threadist, I didn't look interesting. Well, maybe somebody was inspired. This was 1934. And what was that one? Oh no, was I completely wrong? No, I can't. Well, they have a relationship. 1870s. Okay, cool. That's great. That's still completely okay with me. She didn't make it. But she totally saw it. Charles, I think you had it. Did you have it? Yeah, the stars are similar. I mean, you know, good artists borrow, great artists steal. That's the saying. That's the way it goes. You know, that's what people say. Okay. So we're going to talk about the century of progress today. Quilts from the century of progress. Gamer Granny, maybe they had the same teacher. Yes, exactly. And it's New England, so. So we're going to talk about this, but first I'm going to tell you, wait a minute, hold on, hold on. Hold on, hold on, hold on. I don't want that one. I don't want that one. I want this one. Sorry. Yeah, this is what we're starting with. I'm going to zoom in really, really big. Yep, not that first one. Sorry. so I have, there's some changes to the show. And I've been thinking so hard about everything. And the changes that I want to make are, I was telling Eric, you know, as we were talking about all this and I was working on so many things. I mean, I've been working on the show since I saw you last. And I was telling him, I was like, okay, like I see the path. I know some tweaks I need to make to everything. And for a moment, I was like, I'm scared of the changes, and I hope people will, you know, like go with me on this and like they'll understand and be excited about the changes too, and don't worry. And I was like, oh no, what's gonna happen? And I don't know what's gonna happen, but I'm so sure, I'm so sure that what I'm gonna do is right, that it's gonna work, that I don't. There's a part of me that's not afraid. I am going to go to two shows a week. The reason that I'm going to do that is not because what I'm doing, we're doing, isn't working. I'm going to go to two shows a week, you guys, because it is working. There's other reasons why, I'll tell you, but when I started the show, I put it three shows a week because I needed to learn this thing. I wanted to get in hours. I wanted to log hours. And I also just immediately loved it. So it was like, I want to do this. And then I started making friends with you all, and I was like, ah, so I'm doing it. And I wanted to get to a point on Twitch where I was able to be an affiliate, which means I can have emotes and all this kind of stuff. Okay. Oh, Susan, God, you're the first comment I saw. And I know some of you are like, hang on. And the thing is that for subscribers, most of you, just a couple of you are like tier two subscribers at $9.99 a month, just sort of blindly, just like, go marry, this show is worth $10 a month to me. Like, I just support this, this startup, right? And I really appreciate you. But most of you who subscribe are $4.99 a month members. See, now I'm getting nervous. And many of you, hopefully a lot of you, are subscribing through Amazon Prime, because if you're a Prime member, you get a free subscription to one Twitch channel every month, and each month you get to have a free subscription. So for a lot of you're subscribers, and it doesn't cost you anything, which is really cool. So as I have gone on, I mean, it'll be a year next in June, at the end of June. This is episode 126. And I have realized, and I'm gonna read your comments, but it's like I have to get through this part. Oh, thank God. Okay. Yes, okay, good. Yes, exactly. Okay. I mean, I wasn't scared, but I also so I want you to believe in this, and I want you to get your money's worth. And so it's like to take a show away feels, it's like I can understand how someone would be like, that's not what I was sold. I mean, it's like that's not what I signed up for, literally, because like I'm gonna get a subscription to this show. It's three shows a week, and sometimes it's four. But I believe in my heart, I know that to grow this channel, I have to take a stream out. Because in the past 2 days I didn't stream. I made a video for YouTube. I made half of another video for YouTube and did a bunch of other stuff I'll tell you about. But over and over, every single video I watch about how to grow your Twitch channel and what to do about, all this marketing stuff and everything, everybody says you have to make content for YouTube. It's not because you should be on YouTube all the time or live streaming from YouTube. That's not why. It's that every single time you make a piece of recorded content and you say that you stream on Twitch and, here's this video, watch me live on Twitch. Every single time anybody watches that video, if you have it at the beginning, they see it. It's an ad. It's an ad on TV, basically. And for months, I have had on my list, make YouTube videos, make a YouTube video, make a video, make a video. Romar Bearden, I've been talking about it for months. There's just no time. Because, and I know you came for content, and I'm like, we're gonna get there. But this is really important. It's really important. I gotta tell you. Thank you. Yes, exactly. And that's the other thing. That's the other thing. Molly's like, I was worried about burnout. Yeah, and Hootsie says too, I'm cool with two, can't make every live show. It's gonna be easier on y'all. And I'm not saying like, because you all come to every show, because I know most of you, well, most of you can't. And like I say, I watch live streams, I love my live streams. I feel guilty when I miss a show because I love the girl who does the live stream, and I'm like, oh, I don't want her to have a low number today, I know how that feels, so I gotta tune in. But three shows is a lot for people who love the show too. And so I was thinking, like, maybe some people who subscribe. Hey, Pen Burrito. Oh, I'm so glad. Oh, God, yes. See, I get worried about stuff, and it's like, chill out. But if I'm on a little less, then maybe you'll. God, okay. I was thinking some people that subscribe might be missing a lot of shows, and they're like, I don't see the show. There's so many shows, and I get to like one every 2 weeks. I don't think I'm really getting my money. I don't think it really makes sense for me to subscribe. Well, with fewer shows, it's kind of more special. And so maybe you'll feel like, yeah, this is great. I love, So three are tough to keep up with. Exactly, Niflinster. Exactly. Oh, you got your back. I'm not gonna cry. Yeah, Meyer listens at parties. Pastrami Tacos found the stream through YouTube. It is totally the case. It is like, that's where people find the stream, because quilters aren't on Twitch. And I knew that. We've talked about it. We'll go into it. I feel very good about being here. I love this platform. So I made a whole video like in the past couple of days. I couldn't believe it. And it was so much fun. I loved making it. And so not having the stream on Tuesday night was crazy. I was like, because it's for you two, it's if I'm streaming three times a week, and then I'm going to move on because I think we've talked about it. But, you know, if I'm streaming three times a week, sometimes these streams are like 2.5 hours. Every once in a while, they're three. It's like 9 hours every week. But that's not all the prep. You know what I'm saying? And the other thing, see, I had my little list. Benefits of two shows a week. Because I wanted to, you know, make sure you understood. The channel can grow. You'll miss me, you know? I'm not in your face all the time. So you're like, oh my God. It's Quilner Night. Oh, this is great. You know, you won't get tired of me. I get tired of me. And my anxiety will go down. It has to happen. Molly mentioned burnout. It's not sustainable. I get really nervous before the show. I'm running around frantic. Eric can tell you. Eric, just, you don't have to say anything. So it's going to be better. I'm really glad that you understand, and I think that you understand. Jill says, with people, oh, Myra, you naughty, naughty girl. With fewer shows, Jill says, people will then watch reruns on YouTube when they need some nerding, which will boost YouTube views as well. Oh, that's good. Very good. Which two nights of the week? An excellent question. So, very interesting. Prairie Susie, can I recommend the nerds pick an older show to rewatch? I'm sure there are things I missed when I watched the shows live. Well, this transitions us well. Two things. Number one, Saucy Stitcher. There are these things called analytics, you know. That word makes my eyes like glaze over, you know. I'm like all about like creativity, content, you know, woo, and like analytics. But it turns out Thursday night, it's much lower than Tuesday and Saturday. So the show is now going to be on Tuesday nights at 7 p.m., just like always. And Saturday nights at 8 p.m., just like always. And it's an hour later on Saturday because it's the weekend, you know? And like, I don't know, it's just been that way. I'm not going to change that. we're not messing with the hours, okay? Tuesday night at 7 p.m. is a great night. Tuesday night's great. People are like tuning in. Saturday night, it's great because once you're a quilt nerd, you're not going out. Well, I mean, you are. No, I don't mean that. But just like, you know, like this is us, you know, we like Saturday nights, you know, hanging out. And Jessica, great. That's great. Oh, good. I'm so glad. Oh, God, what was I afraid of? I was afraid I was going to get overwhelmed and tired. The time is precious and you cherish it, so you say, Myra, but it's not if it comes at a high mental and emotional cost. We love you. I love you too. And that's why I started this off by saying this is good because it's working, not because it's not working. So thank you so much for understanding. Oh, my stomach. Wow. Did you hear that? You probably did. Whoa. Okay. So that's the scoop. The other thing, and this is now it's just gravy, you know, just gravy. What Saucy Stitcher said. Wait a minute. Who said? No. Who said? Watch older. Yes, Prairie. The video that I made, which is on my YouTube channel, is a quilt nerd short. The quilt nerd short. Hang on. Why am I small? I could be big. Just goodness. Look at this. This is crazy. Hang on. Just a minute. This is great. It was like a hate look. Aww. You know, like, so the video I made is a quilt nerd short, and you know what it is? I took a portion of the show. We have hundreds of hours of content, hundreds. I've done the work. I said the stuff, I read the things. So I took a portion of the Jean Ray, I read from Jean Ray Laurie, a text from Jean Ray Laurie months ago. About keep writing, you know, quilters and writing. And I like cut it down. Hey, Bonnie, thanks for subscribing. I appreciate you. And I cut it down into a 4-minute and 44-second video. And it was really fun from the show. So people see what the show is like, plus a little extra. I did some animation, which is like super janky, but I loved it. It was fun and I could do it. I didn't have to write a whole new script and like record a whole new thing and like do my makeup and like whatever. So it's taken from the show. So there'll be quilt nerd shorts about like everything we talk about, including the Century of Progress, for example, or Crazy City. So there'll be these little edited, tiny, bite-size quilt nerd shorts. You know, I think, yeah, because I think the live stream, if you're not in the live stream like zone, if you're not like a live stream person yet, a 2-hour video scares you, you know, on YouTube, but a 2-minute video, you're going to love it. Herb Slops, thank you for subscribing. It's already working. You see, Herb Slops is like, I can get behind this plan. So this is going to be good. This is going to be good. Yes. And Jill Alex, that is one other thing. We are still doing Culture's Newsletter Friday every other week. So some weeks there will be 3 shows, but it won't be 3 in a row. As Myra and Padma, I think, has always been concerned. Rightly so. Padma, I printed off. I mean, I wrote down everybody's feedback. Look, show schedule feedback from the nerds. I'm keeping track of everything. The last thing I'm going to say about this, because thank you for, oh, it's just, make that quilt halo a thumbnail. Oh, that's really good. Yeah, why don't I just do, I mean, why not have this? no, I don't like it. Dana, thank you. Thank you for giving that sub. That's awesome. Oh, Herb Slops, you got a gift sub. That's awesome. That's great. Quilt Nerd Bites. Oh, except that maybe it sounds like Quilt Nerd sucks. Quilt Nerd Bites. I don't think people really say Quilt Nerd Bites, but Pen Burrito, I am so glad that you were here too. You have always been very awesome in helping me get things sorted. Your hubby secretly listens, Sue says, likes the new plan too. Oh, oh no, don't tell anyone. Well, the husbands and the spouses and the partners probably will be like okay with this, because sometimes I steal you away for hours and hours every week. Quilt Nerd Shorts, Patchwork Shorts. So the other thing, the other change, which will be awesome too, is that somebody gave me a great suggestion of doing like an intro video for the show. Basically like, you know, like that plays at the top of the show. That maybe if I do wait to start until 7:10, which, or I mean 10 after, which maybe is too long. You know, maybe I need to jump in, you know, a little sooner. I don't know. Gonna figure that out. But all this info, Prime subscription's free, what the live stream's about, that the disc, what you get when you subscribe, you know, Discord access, entered into the drawings, like all of that little stuff that's important, I can make like an intro video that like plays at the top of the hour. And then it's like, hey everybody, how's it going? Oh, damn. I was gonna put this on for the opening quilt. You know, like when we're talking about the opening quilt, little music. See, I forgot. Polly! Hey, Bridgewater, thank you so much. You gifted a sub to Polly. That's awesome. Polly, I hope you stick around. It's going to get better and better from here. Like, it's been a great 10 months. So it's going to get better. So now I'm going to have music behind me when I come in after that intro video, you know? It won't be too loud. Figure it out. Stuff like this, you guys. So, I mean, I feel real good about it. If you hate the music, we won't keep it, but yeah. And thank you. And here we go. It's like 2.0, you guys. Like, really. The YouTube shorts, it's gonna be good. It's gonna be real good. So, we did a hype train. Okay. Talk show intro music. Yes. Okay. You like it. Good. Good. Yep. Music, old clips, the whole nine. Love it. Yes. 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 Being a mom comes with pros and cons. One of the cons is that I'm in demand all the time. I just spent the last 20 minutes putting back together my son's Lego mansion that got broke. What did you miss? I'll put some stuff in the Discord and I'll announce it for a little while and I'll do some stuff to get the word out, but we're going to 2 shows a week, Kitty Hannah, and you're in the group, you're in the mix, so you'll get filled in, you know, as we go along, maybe in the disco or whatnot. But it's good. You know what it is? It's pruning. It's pruning the rose bush. I don't like that. Pruning the rose bush so the roses will grow. And the other thing that someone mentioned is in that intro video, I can talk about the Abe Books thing. You know, all that stuff, like, I don't have to talk about in the show, so we can get to the goods. We can get to the goods. You like that? Okay, great. Kitty's like, I don't need to hear anything else. I'm good. Really, it's great. Okay. So, the Quilt Nerd Shorts. This is going to be a Quilt Nerd Short. This chapter, this event that we're going to have right now about the Century of Progress Quilt Contest. And it's huge. And talk about iconic. It's amazing. I got to get small. What I'm going to do now after all this excitement, I mean, I need to use the ladies' room and take a deep breath. And so we're going to take a quick break and come back with some of the most amazing quilts you've ever seen. I'm not just saying it. You will, I mean, just, you don't have to believe me. You're going to look at this. Look, hold on. Just let me just show you one more. That first one snuck in there because I did a search on my computer for fair. Look, how about this? What do you think about this? There's so many, like I could just pick any of them. Look at this quilt. These are going to blow your mind. And they are all from a contest that was just, I mean, I think it was a turning point for quilts in America that happened in the 1930s during the worst year of the Great Depression here in Chicago, the Sears Century of Progress National Quilt Contest. And you are in for a treat. So I'll be right back. I'm going to get some crisps and use the ladies' room, and I'll see you in just a second. I love you.
Thank you.
Okay, we're back. And if you're new here, we used to call this show Quilt Church because that's what we think it is, really. And some of the things you all have said over the course of the time we've been doing this is that, and I believe it, is that this content is awesome. And I don't mean like, oh, I give you great content, but that the kind of show that this is, that it's this, you know, quilt history, quilt culture. I don't want to say scholarship because it's not a presentation, it's an exploration. There's nothing else like it. There's not. And we want it to grow because the more it grows, the more friends we'll make. Really. I mean, you're awesome. So, like, if there's double you, that's great. And then if there's like triple you know what I'm saying? So that's the deal. And I have to do a bunch of other jobs to make a living. What if this was all I had to do? Hey, it's possible. Then I'd get a producer so I don't have to like host, produce, show run, and be IT. Wow. Oh, and I was just looking at a couple of people just glancing while I was getting things together here, and a bunch of people were like, we were super afraid Mary was gonna burn out. And I'm like, oh God, I wasn't afraid, but that's how burnout happens. Creeps up on you. So this is very good. So Tuesday at 7. Oh God, yes. Quilting Politic. We are an effing cool group of people, and I love you all. I don't even know what to do. God, I don't even know. Tuesday at 7, Saturdays at 8 p.m. No Thursday show. Thursday is quiet. Thursday is a quiet night. And Quilters Newsletter Friday every other Friday. So next Friday, the 6th, next Friday, Quilters Newsletter Friday. And Myra says, Mary, we all love you. Ah. We all want what's best for you, and the show will sort itself out. You do so much as it is. Thank you. Thank you. And also we want you to stay healthy. Your tummy. Thank you. Yeah, that is Eric's wish as well. You know what's interesting? Okay, I'm gonna start. Oh, that's a good question, Susan. Let me come back to it. Let me jump in here. Let me jump in here for the folks who for the folks at home. Okay, we'll get to. I mean, I that's the why the show gets long is because I just wanna chat. Where's my stuff? Okay. So the Century of Progress exhibit. Or sorry, the Century of Progress contest. I'm gonna tell you what I know about it. This is a book that's on the Quilt Nerd affiliate link sheet. Maybe one of my mods could drop in the affiliate link. I'm an A Books affiliate, so all the books that I recommend, pretty much all of them on the show are out of print. So you know, it's not like I'm taking any money from authors. I mean, I don't know how that works, but anyway, you know, most of the books I recommend are like $5 on, you know, Abe Books because they're out of print. And I can tell you, I mean, I think I can tell you, it's just an idea that, you know, Quilt Folk published the second edition of Rod Kirikoff's wonderful book, Unconventional and Unexpected. And I have other books I want to do a second edition of, including this one. This is Patchwork Souvenirs of the 1933 World's Fair and the Sears National Quilt Contest and Chicago's Century of Progress Exposition by Mary K. Waldvogel and Barbara Brackman. It was published, and I'll be reading to you from this because this is a book about this thing that I'm talking about, okay? And you'll know lots more here presently. This was published in 1993. And it's wonderful. It's so great. And it needs to be out there again because the Century of Progress, thanks, Word and Bird Nerd. The Century of Progress, let me get, hold on, I'll go back to this app. Century of Progress Quilt Contest was like, to me, it's the most exciting moment in American quilt making history. Either tied with the Whitney Museum of Art exhibit, or just ahead or just behind it. So it's not that, I mean, it's, it, be, okay. So there's really exciting things always happening in the quilt world, but there were these watershed events, these big sort of, like marking posts, cornerstones, I don't know, one of those sort of heavy objects in the timeline, right, of quilts in America. And the Whitney Museum of Art in 1971 was a really big deal because it put quilts in a major museum for the first time. The Whitney Museum of American Art had quilts on the wall, and that was a really big moment for quilts. But in 1933, and now I'm going to tell you what I know about this, and then we'll get into some more details. But in 1933, the city of Chicago hosted the World's Fair, the Columbia Exposition, the World's Fair. And this, if you've read, has anybody read Devil in the White City? Perhaps that was a really hot book years ago. I mean, maybe even 20 years ago. But Devil in the White City was like a bestseller, and it's watershed. Thank you, Susan. And Kitty Hanna, Barbara Brackman has written like 9,000 books. Milestones, yeah. And Devil in the White City was about, it was a murder, it was a true crime kind of thing about this terrible murderer who was murdering people, women, in Chicago at the time of the Chicago World's Fair. And I read it. I don't like true crime very much. I think it's terrible. Life's scary enough. But the book was popular because it was well written and it moved fast, but it also gave you a really good sense of the Chicago World's Fair. And the Chicago World's Fair, you should know that in 1933, 1934 was like, it was the worst years of the Depression. It was the nadir of the Depression. Yeah, I know, Lily, weird. It was a great book, Jan. I remember, I think in some Ken Burns film, I remember very well learning that in this city that I'm in Chicago, they shot animals in the zoo for meat. That happened here because people were hungry, and unemployment was 25% in the United States in 1933. And the Depression was really at its worst. And so to have a Columbian Exposition, to have a World's Fair at all, was like crazy. Chicago won the bid. And so if you've been to Chicago, if you know anything about Chicago, you know, one of the most extraordinary things about Chicago, one of the most fabulous things, is the architecture here. And one of the people who was behind all of that, of course, there's many people, Louis Sullivan and Mies van der Rohe and all that, but Daniel Burnham was this powerhouse architect and designer, urban developer, really, who built a lot of the buildings, who designed a lot of the buildings that were built in Chicago for the Chicago World's Fair. And many of the buildings that you have maybe visited for a tourist purpose, or maybe you know Chicago, the Adler Planetarium, the Field Museum, the Art Institute, I'm not remembering. Yes, Ferris Bueller, exactly. Hey, Caitlin, it was about 1893. Oh, no, you're right. That's 1893. Okay. So Daniel Burnham. This was the 1893 World's Fair. I am getting them mixed up. It's true. I'm mixing up my World's Fairs. That's okay. So Chicago was known for being a World's Fair city. Okay. And Daniel Burnham, you're right. 1893 World's Fair. So in 1933, Chicago wins the World's Fair exhibition location again. And probably because we had done it so successfully with Daniel Burnham, okay, we got the World's Fair, and it was kind of crazy. Let me show you a couple. This is a fair, like a souvenir. Hang on one second. Go over here. I want you to come here. Being, you know, since it was such a terrible time, you know, I mean, the fair organizers were like, is anybody even going to come? You know, like, what is this going to do for the city? Is it going to be good or bad? And thank you. Yeah, it scared me too, Bonnie. But they did it. They did it anyway. And they built all these different buildings. And the Sears Roebuck Company was here in Chicago. The Sears Tower used to be the Sears Tower, and now it's the Willis Tower. But Sears Roebuck and Company was based in Chicago. And because they've always been very good at selling stuff and good marketers, Sears sponsored a quilt contest for the 1933 World's Fair in Chicago. And they put out the ads for it. Here's just a, look at that. Entrance to the Field Museum, A Century of Progress. They put out the call, and it went, you know, into the newspapers and things all over the country that Sears was going to sponsor a quilt contest. And here is, so this is the cover of some of the ephemera that we have from the contest. And it says, Century of Progress in Quilt Making. You can bake a sweet cake. Zoom in here. But can you sew a fine seam? If so, take your place among the geniuses of the world, for quilt making has again come into its own, is again one of the fine arts. Wow. Okay. So they issued this contest. And look here on the side. Okay, I'm going to go over here. Sears Century of Progress Quilt Contest. $75,000 in prizes they were giving out for this quilt contest. So they issued this announcement, and this was the brochure about all like the rules. And of course, Sears wanted you to purchase things at their store. You know, it's like, look, they say right up at the top, you know, your quilting needs, buy your quilting needs where you're sure to be pleased. At Sears, of course, the items listed below may be found in the Sears sale book or a big general catalog. Refer to the catalog index, da 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 da. So they're like, you know, enter this 7,500. Did I say 75,000? See, I got nervous about that whole mixing up the World's Fair things. $7,500 in prize money. Okay, so like the total prize money that they were offering was, you know, was just a huge amount at that time. I mean, you could buy a kit home from the Sears catalog at that time, and during the Depression, I mean, people were hungry. Some people were just totally destitute at that time. So the idea that they could make a quilt, this is part of the brochure as well. The people who could potentially make a quilt, I'm going to hide the chat just for a second, and win. I mean, this was a very, very exciting proposition. So roughly, were entered into the contest. 25,000 quilts from all over the country. And in the book, Patchwork Souvenirs, by Mary Kay Waldvogel and Barbara Rackman, published in 1993, they talk much more about the details of this, that there were regional offices, and you had your regional office, and you would send your quilt into the specific office and all of that. And they talk, you know, about the specific makers. And I'm going to show you some of the quilts, of course, that are some of my favorites of that time. But Eleanor Roosevelt would write the winner a letter. If you won the grand prize, there were other prizes. There was the grand prize, and it says so it says a total of $7,500 in prizes will be awarded, and in addition, all prize winning quilts will receive ribbons according to rank. Winners will be announced, and quilts will be returned after the judging is complete, about June 15, 1933. All of the regional winners will be exhibited in the Sears building at the Century of Progress Exposition, which opens in Chicago June 1st. The quilt winning the Grand National Prize will be presented to the First Lady of the Land at the White House, Eleanor Roosevelt. So she would get the winning quilt. Mail order house prizes. The national prize, the Grand National Prize, $1,000. Second national prize, $500. So this was big money. This was big money. And there was extra like incentive. There was extra money, or there was like incentive to incorporate the theme of that year's World's Fair, the Chicago Exposition, or the Columbian Exposition. If you incorporated the theme of the fair into your quilt, you got like bonus points, you know, or there was like, you know, you could win extra money or whatever. They wanted you to do that. And the theme of the fair was the Century of Progress. Century of Progress. Okay. So UFO at the top of the tower. Totally. This is the Sears Roebuck Tower at the World's Fair. This is what they built for the, and this is where the quilts would be exhibited, is in this building. Okay. Here is another picture of this Sears building. Okay. The Sears Roebuck and Company building at the Chicago World's Fair. I don't know. It probably says in this book if that is Michigan Avenue. I'm not sure. I would definitely like to know. There are maps of the fair. There were souvenir books, you know, that were absolutely kept by people. Is the building still there? No, I do not believe so, Kenny Hannah. I could be wrong. Remember, this is all an exploration, not a presentation. Not that you expected me to know, but I just want to point that out, that I don't know everything about, you know, where things were. But I know that the quilts were to be exhibited, the regional winners and stuff, at this fair. Okay. So 25,000, roughly, people sent in quilts into this contest. And the quilts that they made are amazing. Not every quilt that was sent in was amazing, of course. With 25,000 quilts, you know, you're going to get a wide variety. But one of the things that is so extraordinary about this moment in quilt history is that there was so much imagination and innovation and exploration in the quilts that came out of this time. And they announced, I forget when they announced the contest, but there was only like a matter of months. It wasn't 2 years before the World's Fair that they announced that this thing was going to take place. I think it was a matter of months. I mean, it wasn't long. It wasn't over a year. And so people produced these quilts and sent them in quickly. So this, for example, yeah, temporary, exactly, Bridgewater, which is why the Chicago World's Fair in 1893, the World's Fair in Chicago was different. Because, I mean, I think all the buildings like the Planetarium and the Field Museum and the Institute and everything, you know, those were made to be permanent, or they became permanent. I remember Devil in the White City talked about how a lot of the buildings were like just facades. You know, so that's something I actually have been thinking about. I think about it fairly frequently when I go down museum campus. I'm walking around. I'm like, what was the thing with the World's Fair? Did they build them to last, or did they build them sort of to be temporary and then make them permanent? Some of you may know. So this quilt, for example, and I just have a parade of amazing quilts for you. Okay, some of my favorites from the Patchwork Souvenirs book, but also from other books that I have come across. You know, I've come across different quilts and scanned them for you to show them to you because they're really special. This quilt, it's called Century of Progress, okay? It's 82 by 70. And here's what it says, and this is from a book that I have by Woodard and Greenstein, which I'll talk about later, but there's many quilts to show you, so I'll just go forward. With this, to illustrate the idea of progress, the theme of the 1933 Chicago Fair, this quilter focused on transportation. From the stagecoach and locomotive, both dated 1835, to the automobile and airplane of 1933, building progress is represented by four blocks showing a log cabin, a country church, skyscrapers, and a large church. The futuristic building at the center is the Century of Progress building. You'll see this again. The Century of Progress building itself. The American Eagle, a car, and two locomotives are included in the exceptionally fine quilting. So what you'll see in some of these quilts, I know, Kitty. Okay, Caitlin, I actually need to go on an architectural tour of my own city. What you'll see is that some people incorporated the theme of the World's Fair in the quilting. I just heard an alert. In the quilting, some people incorporated it in the piecing. But this person, I mean, is this silk? Does it say? This doesn't say if it's silk. It sure looks like it. But these silhouettes placed, you know, strategically, look at the airplane. I mean, just look at the detail of the airplane. And this, look at the cowboy above my head. Let me turn it. I mean, it's amazing. Look at the ship. Look at the ship. It's really something. Yeah, the lasso. Yeah, he's got a lasso, right? Quilted in. Okay, so I mean, there's, I can't, I mean, we gotta keep it pushing because there's just so many. Okay. All right, so this one, again, and the quilting is insane. So this one is by Emma May Leonard, and it's called From 1833 to 1933. And this one, in a way, this one is like sort of tame by comparison because some of the quilts are so weird, which you will see. But this one is amazing because for one thing, she's doing the Century of Progress building again. This building that you're seeing in between the ladies, that's the Century of Progress building, or it's the Sears building. I don't know. Actually, let's find out. I have some information for you. Designed and pieced by Emma May Leonard. Look at this. Look at this. Now, this is a great picture. Look at that eagle. Look at the quilting there. I know. I know. They look like they were made with a cry cut. Yeah. Or a Cricut. Yeah, I know what that is. We got tacos in the chat. Exactly. So, Virginia. Okay, Virginia, Illinois. So she was from Illinois. The entrance. Oh, hang on, where's my thing? Okay. The entrance form for the 1933 Chicago Quilt Contest is still attached to the lower left corner of this tour de force quilt. Oh, I suppose we'll see it in just a moment. With houses juxtaposed against pastel skyscrapers, plus a chronology of women's and military fashions. Really? Wow. Oh, look at that. Person of color there. I didn't notice that before. Cool. It charts a century of progress as required by the contest guidelines. An English teacher, Ms. Leonard pointed out in her notes that she sacrificed historical exactness in terms of the colors she chose for the uniforms pictured in her quilt for the sake of, quote, daintiness of the color scheme in the whole quilt, unquote. The evolution of transportation is also illustrated in the fine quilting in the top and bottom borders. Wow, look at the eagle. The quilting is insane. I mean, there are more like wild quilts, as we'll see, but I mean, the quilting in this one, look at the flapper. I mean, kind of the clothes change. I know, Lily. I mean, I hadn't noticed that there was a non-white woman there. I mean, that's just like, okay, groovy. Because, there's other quilts with portraits and things, and it's pretty white, so that's a difference. It's great. Yeah, military uniforms, and so I mean, I thought this was the Century of Progress building or the Sears building, but perhaps it's just a skyscraper. Oh wow, look at this! Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my God! Hold on, hold on. Look at the train! Look at the train down there. 1933 grain stock. I thought it said tacos, but it says stock. Cotton. The train and the airplane under there. She was in yellow. Oh yeah, did somebody see it? The block's border that looks empty, it isn't. Yeah, exactly. It's these feathers and this wonderful stuff. Do you think they were machine quilting at all then? Thretis, that's a very good question. I feel like at this time, like what I kind of have a sense of is that there was machine piecing but hand quilting. And somewhere, oh well, hang on. Somewhere, I don't have a picture. This picture doesn't have the label on it or the tag on it. This picture gets around a lot. These Century of Progress quilts, some of them are also kind of like Crazy City. They're just reproduced a lot because they're so special. So I don't know, but some of the pictures that will be seen, you'll see in these different books, will have more details about whether it was hand quilted or machine pieced, hand quilted, all that. So this one. I mean, it's so cool. The people, Wes Anderson, really love it. World's Fair building. I mean, this quilter is just like, I'm going for it. The person who made this is Helen E. Billick from Gary, Indiana, 63 by 81. It's in the collection of the Illinois State Museum in Springfield. Look how that is rendered. That is really detailed, and it's beautifully drafted and rendered. It's just I mean, if you think about what people were doing, I mean, I don't know. Like, there are the Bertha Meckstroths of the world, these the Bertha Stengys, the Mary Gasparics. We've talked about some of these like legendary, fabulously talented, technically brilliant quilt makers of this sort of period, this kind of general period. And they were doing stuff like detailed, kind of three-dimensional kind of stuff, you know? And maybe this person was doing this kind of thing too, but I just feel like there's a lot of these quilts that look so iconoclastic, so different. They're not just pieced blocks, they're artistic. And I feel like it was so beautiful how many of these quilts came from this time because people were so, I mean, maybe the money was so motivating to them that they just did everything they could, you know, to make exceptional quilts that really stood out to win. It's just, I mean, there ought to be, yeah, somebody mentioned Ken Burns, you know, a documentary about it. I mean, absolutely, you know, absolutely. That's the other thing. I gotta have time to work on my documentary project, which is always on. It's always on, and I had some good phone calls about it this week. Anyway, making a quilt with the word quilt on it. Making a word of the quilt. That amount of hand quilting with a quick turnaround. Yeah. None of these ladies went to art school. Yeah, probably. I agree. I'm sure that you're right. Okay, by the way, look at this thing up here. See this little like saucer dish? It's up in the corner. It's kind of hard to tell what it is, but soon you will know what this person was going for. Helen entered this contest in the Century of Progress. Helen entered this quilt in the Century of Progress contest. She didn't win a prize, but she did keep a scrapbook about her experience that included correspondence from Sears officials. Interesting. Very interesting. Oh, this one's got a lot to look at. All right, let's zoom in on this. Okay, I can put that book away and get this back out. This was featured in the Quilters Newsletter, sort of the collab that a bunch of people did, the 20th Century's Best American Quilts. So this is considered one of the country's, or one of the century's, the 20th century's best quilts. Now, what's interesting is that they did not say anything about the Century of Progress when they talked about it in that publication. But I have found elsewhere that it was a Century of Progress entered quilt. So I'm going with it. Padma. Ooh. Ken Burns is a quilt collector, Kenny. He indeed is. I got to interview him for like 10 minutes a couple of years ago. It was very exciting. He is a quilt collector, and there's an exhibit at Peoria in the Peoria Riverfront Museum right now for maybe 3 more weeks of the Ken Burns quilt collection. So if anybody's near to Peoria, you should definitely go and see it. It's only been exhibited twice, once at the International Quilt Museum and now at Peoria. Padma says, according to the article by Kimberly Wilfert, the sewing machine and quilters in the 19th century. Article here that by Kimberly Wilfert, machine quilting was more likely between the 1880s and 1890s. Interesting. Interesting. Kimberly Wilfert. Oh, yeah. What was it in that one show Mary read? A person could hand quilt 5 yards per hour. That is insane. It's insane. Okay. Well, little is known about the quilt maker and how she came to make this quilt. By the way, her name was Mrs. Cecil White. This quilt was made in 1930 and 77 by 66. Okay. So little is known about Mrs. Cecil White. The quilt can be enjoyed by anyone who studies vignettes. I need to get closer. These are pretty small. Studies the vignettes of American life that she depicts. Mrs. White was a keen observer of human activity and perhaps an avid reader of the comics, for the portrayals seem to reflect a similar style to cartoon art. Innocent of political correctness. Oh, snap. I have not looked at that part of this. She depicts 1930s. Oh, God. Hey, this is the quilt, man. I mean, American quilts, they tell American history, and it ain't pretty sometimes. God, I hope it's not too awful. I mean, sorry. She depicts 1930 stereotypes of ethnic groups, Engage in exaggerated moments of activity. Illustrations include rural scenes, sports, dancing, a shoeshine parlor, a police chase, a wedding, an elopement, a portrait painting, and a trolley ride. Mrs. White's choice of a variety of background fabrics for the blocks increases the depth perception so that the eye seems to move in and out of the frame. Interesting. The narrow black sashing, zoom out here, dotted with red circular, sorry, I cursed, but yeah, it's live. The narrow black sashing dotted with red circular shapes at the intersections sets the scenes apart in a witty manner. That's true. I had not considered that. That's very true. The black border is appliqued with late models of automobiles, trucks, and trains to set the final note of modernity. Yeah, if there's something gross here, that's, I mean, it's 1933, I guess. Like, that, it's very interesting. Yeah, it looks like most of the things. Well, okay. Like, I don't know. I mean, I have to look at it myself. I haven't, like, looked carefully at it. So maybe things are awful, and maybe, I mean, that's an interracial couple, and that's not, like, you know, the devil himself is not, like, you know, creeping out of the corner. So that's, you know, I mean, there's very interesting things happening here. Definitely, definitely is worth a very close look. Cops and robbers. Carrying something. It's kind of a, sort of maybe Chinese or Japanese jacket of some kind. Anyway, it's very interesting. But I really think that's true about the comics. There's a little milkmaid up there. And the red dots, you know, in between. That's very, very interesting. I love it. I think it's really neat. Hopefully things are not terrible. Okay. Was this at Quilts in America exhibit at Boston MFA? Was it? It may have been. I don't know. Because I don't have my book of that exhibit. But it might have been. Okay. Okay, let's move on. We gotta move on. There's more quilts. Okay, this one. This one, kind of classically patriotic, but look at the work. Look at the scalloped edge. It was there. Okay, J. Dancer. J. Dancer. This one, Mrs. W.B. Lathouse from Ohio. The Century of Progress Exposition inspired quilters across the nation to dig into our history for subjects relating to patriotism and progress. Pictured are Franklin Delano Roosevelt, under the caption, Hope of a Nation, and Abraham Lincoln, the Emancipator. Transportation is highlighted with an applique Mayflower, the airship Macon, a bicycle, train, balloon, and automobile. Modern appliances such as a washing machine and a vacuum cleaner illustrate how things have progressed from the simple country life depicted at the bottom of the central panel. How things have progressed from the simple country life depicted at the bottom of the central panel. Amazing. Amazing. Hey, L. Riggs. Oh, I'm so glad. Glad I can catch some of the love show, too. I think you mean the live show, but I'll take that. Take it. Okay, now we get into some really interesting stuff. I mean, it's all interesting, but this quilt, this is kind of a famous one, too. Look at what's going on here. What's kind of funny is I think this guy looks like Jimmy Carter, but it's not because Jimmy Carter was not the president yet. This quilt, I mean, it looks like she's working with transparencies. Let me zoom out again real quick. Love show, like the love chat. Exactly, Worden Bernard. It looks like a transparency somehow because of the colors used. And this solid orange and the very, very, very pale peach. And then that sort of strange faded sherbet. I mean, it's really interesting in all the writing around. So here's what's going on here. Made by Clarence and Linda Riebenstoff. And you have to think too, like people were probably, and there are many quilts that have multiple names on them, but like families working together to get a quilt done, you know, in time to enter, in time for the deadline of the contest. And L. Riggs, we're talking about the Century of Progress World's Fair. In Chicago in 1933, 34, there was a quilt contest sponsored by Sears, and 25,000 people entered it. And some of the quilts are just so extraordinary. So this quilt was made for the World's Fair contest, okay. It represents innovations and progress from 1833 to 1933 in aviation, farm machinery. Look at this lady. She was like the figurehead of the fair, this lady. Farm machinery, education, and art. The names around the outside are outstanding contributors in their respective fields. The modern woman in the center represents giving women, quote unquote, credit for helping man achieve his dreams. Oh, yeah. Uh-oh. Feminist quilt maker in the house. That's interesting. I didn't know that. All the little tidbits about these quilts are fascinating. The offensive, oh, Jay Dancer, the offensive stuff in the previous quilt was a few black figures with exaggerated features, almost like blackface, but thought it was interesting. There was also an interracial couple. Same, you know, like that exaggeration, you know, that's interesting. I mean, other things might have been exaggerated too. I don't know. And like exaggeration is lame. If they're doing this comic stuff, like it's a weird vibe. But then that interracial couple down in the corner, which is a pretty significant place to put. You know, there's only four corners. The eye goes to these corners, you know, and that was what the quilt maker chose to put in the corner, was a scene of love between a white woman and a black male, or, you know, and that's very intriguing, you know, because you could put a lot of things in the corner that you want people to see if you're trying to send a message of some kind. You know what I'm saying? So thank you for that. Kitty Hannah, speaking of hand quilting, I have a silly question I feel like I should know. I was here back then, they had like 9 or more stitches per inch. Interesting. So does that mean that the needle goes up and down 9 times? Oh, this is a great question. Or is it that the little visible part of the thread on top of the fabric counts as a stitch? And Dee Marie says, I have often read that it is the visible part of the thread on the top of the fabric. Bonnie says up and down. Interesting. That's interesting, Kenny. Kenny. You get a nerd apple for that. It's very good. If this show gets to be like, you know, after we, when the 2-show-a-week thing happens and all the YouTube videos happens and we just, you know, just becomes this empire, I'll be hiring. Kenny, you're my research assistant. You're lead researcher, okay? That's done. Okay. And you can hire anyone else you want on the team because clearly we have people who qualify. Okay. Anyway, that's good. So, yes, this quilt is insane. It's also, you know, the P word, right? Problematic. I mean, there's this hung at the Art Institute. I think it belongs to the Art Institute now. And there was a quilt show a few years ago, I think 2016 or 2017. And this was hanging up and there were people in my textile seminar who were like, you know, not thrilled because it shows scenes of, you know, colonization, the movement west and all of that. And, you know, it's just a very complicated situation. So, and it shows this. So anyway, here's what it says about this. Now, did you get your answer that you wanted, Kitty Hannah? I think it's how many stitches appear on the top of the quilt. So if you're quilting 12 stitches per inch, it's that you can see, you could count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 stitches taken. That's what I think. I really ought to know, but I think I do. This is called Settling the West, okay? And it's by Mildred, designed and made by Mildred Jacob Chapel. 83 by 103, it's pretty big. Conestoga wagons wind their way from east to west across the center of this prize-winning quilt, which bears an embroidered salute to the pioneer as, quote, indomitable and unafraid, unquote. Scenes around the border, also labeled and punctuated by poems, depict Lewis and Clark, Geronimo, the Pony Express, and other legends of the West. A paper label, ribbons, and a commemorative pin remain attached to the back of the piece, reminders of the quilt's success at the Century of Progress National Competition in 1933. By the way, this is one of the 20th century's greatest quilts, 100 greatest quilts. It's also in that. Inscribed on the back, quote, I, Mildred Jacob Chapel, made this labor of love, love for the old West as I have known it in history and books, love of the new West as I have known it in travel. My only regret is that I could not have lived 100 years earlier to experience those stirring times instead of only having made this quilt to commemorate them." Unquote. Well, oh well. Stirring. Stirring, Mildred. Mrs. Elizabeth McCullough, I know I have the chat off the screen still, but I think these quilts are so detailed, we should probably keep it that way, don't you think? I mean, there's a lot of crazy stuff happening here. Yeah, right. Mrs. Elizabeth McCullough of Yuma, Colorado, wrote the following note and attached it to the quilt. Quote, "Slab sides, the Colorado mountain cabin of Mr. and Mrs. H.V. McCullough was the scene of a very interesting gathering on the afternoon of July 31st, 1933, when Mrs. Mildred Chapel, assisted by her daughter of the house, served tea to the guests who came to marvel at the unique design of the quilt and the very skillful workmanship of the maker. During the afternoon, 75 people came to call and visit." Okay. So they had a little party and everybody was like, "Your quilt is amazing. Shall we turn it around and just see what's happening on the bottom?" Doot, doot. Oh, wow. That's making me very dizzy. Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, oxen, a cabin. I know, Lillianne. That's what I'm saying. She's like, "Oh, how I wish I could have experienced those stirring times." I'm like, yeah, stirring your dinner in a cauldron, you know. Sounds great. Scaring off the wildebeests, you know, and exactly. No thanks. But it's amazing. And I've seen it in person and it's really, really something. Okay. Remember that spaceship thing? This is by Ida Mae Schulte, or Schulte, S-C-H-U-L-T-E. And Mary Kay Waldvogel has written this one of the millions of books that I've been saving things from. I can't tell you now. It may be in Robert Shaw's book. Okay, anyway. So just a brief thing about this. So the woman who made this quilt was born on a Missouri farm in 1875 to a family of prolific quilt makers. She decided, she was working in Chicago at her husband's business, and she decided to enter the contest. She and her mom decided to take up the challenge to make a special quilt on the theme of the Century of Progress. And, okay, yeah, and so if they won, they would receive a $200 bonus if they did if they incorporated the theme of the Century of Progress, right, the theme of the fair. So the grand prize, $1,000, and then $200 extra if you were, like, working it with the Century of Progress theme. So, yeah, okay, this is 24,000 entries. So, okay, 24,000 entries into the contest in 1933. And leading up to the contest, Sears offered in-store lectures about historic quilt patterns, advice on making quilts. They sold, you know, stuff in the store. Of course, it was this huge, you know, marketing campaign. Ida's son, the maker of this quilt, Lloyd, remembered, quote, "Ida and her mother made the quilt. They set up a frame in the house. They devoted a whole room to it. It was a massive job," unquote. When she delivered the quilt, Ida attached a typed explanation for the contest judges, quote, "There has been a request for a quilt of unusual or other than colonial design, which would depict and commemorate the century. Therefore, this quilt is submitted for your consideration," unquote. Her design, including the typefaces she used, was based on the Art Deco aesthetics of the 1930s rather than traditional forms. She then commented on the significance of the colors. Blue and gray were the official colors of the Century of Progress, and the official fair logo in the center, which the logo was the world in its progress around the sun. And she commented on her quilting too. Isn't it wonderful, Molly? I know, Art Deco quilts. Mm-hmm. The font is very modern. Exactly. Yep. We only recognize history in the past tense. When we're going through it, we tend to find it annoying. Totally. Submitted for your approval, Rod Sterling. Perfect. Okay, speaking of the okay, look, this is crazy. I've got like eight more for you, okay? And then we've been going on a long time, but I had a lot of announcements. Okay, here. Look at okay, let me just say, this is one of the first quilts I ever saw. Guess what I had? Had some rosé, and after I made my big announcement, I was like, let me just get some of that. Okay. This quilt was one of the first I ever saw that I was like, oh wow. Like I just, it was so different. And I saw it, when mom and I were like first starting to look at her books and we were putting together a lecture, and I like didn't know anything. And I remember seeing this quilt and going, she broke the frame with the circles. She broke the frame with, how are you kidding me? I was like, this is bananas. Oh, I better go like this. You gotta see it. This is bananas. Hey, Pam, you made it back. Welcome back. For one thing, it's really hard. And I mean, just to make any of this. And for another thing, like, what a beautiful, like, weirdo, and so, and what you're looking at here, and now I gotta zoom in. So everybody look at the frame. Everybody see how like the wheel of time or whatever is breaking out of its border. Isn't it amazing, Myra? It's really something. Dee Marie, right? So this is a calendar quilt. Okay, it's called the calendar quilt, and it's made by Lillian Smith Fordyce. It's 90, what is it? 94 by 86.5. This calendar quilt, we're back to Mary Kay, an original design made of the typical multicolored print and solid fabrics of the 1930s, contains a mystery. All right. Although the quilt maker's name is known, the particular circumstances of its making are not. Mary Kay is such a good writer. It is likely, however, it was made an en oh, it was likely it was made as an entrant into the Century of Progress exhibit. Interesting. So she talks about the fair. The maker, Lillian Fordyce, was exceptionally adept at using fabrics and embroidery for appliqued pictorial scenes. The days of the week are represented in the first. This is crazy. The days of the week are represented in the first ring of seven wedges, each showing in remarkable detail the activity appropriate to that day, washing clothes on Monday, for example. The larger ring of 12 wedges shows the months of the year, each appliqued and embroidered to show in fine detail an activity associated with that month, such as planting a garden in April. The solid rings contain the quilted motifs depicting items from the past and progress into the future. Two notable transportation images show an elevated train, like the ones in Chicago, and a zeppelin. Wow, the L is on here. What? That's so cool. I can't see it right now, but I'm definitely going to look for it. Another interesting aspect is that the foundation cloth appears to have come from a kit quilt. Huh. It has slightly scalloped edging, typical of 1930s kit quilts. Also, the outer ring extends beyond the foundation cloth, possibly indicating that Lillian created the ring after she chose the foundation cloth and decided to leave it as it was. Yeah. Brilliant, right? Isn't that cool? Sensational. Wheel of time, so trendy right now. Exactly. Fabulous. Ooh, that's a great idea, Word and Bird Nerd. QuiltCon should have a calendar quilt category like temperature quilts. That's brilliant. You need to suggest it. You do. Okay, I'm gonna do a couple more. There's more. There's always more Century of Progress quilts. I may just actually come back to a couple of them because, there's just so many. I do need to pace myself, you guys. I can't, if the show's 3 hours on a, I don't know, anyway. There's a few favorites, and I'm gonna show you three more quilts. That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna show you three more quilts. Because it's been an intense night, because I knew I had to share lots of announcements and I was nervous about it, so it was extra anxiety. In a good way. So here, this is one of my favorites. This quilt, I'm gonna show you three more brilliant quilts, and then you gotta explore on your own. Century of Progress, get patchwork souvenirs by Mary Kay Waldvogel and Barbara Brackman. it's wonderful. And there's so many Century of Progress quilts bouncing around out there because it was such an important thing that happened. We'll come back to it. This show is going to be on for a very long time. So we can't just like do the Century of Progress and then never talk about it again because it comes up a lot. Okay. So this one, to me, this is one of the most beautiful quilts that's ever been made. And I'm not just saying that. It is amazing. Oh, so I'll show you three more and then I have to show you the quilt that won, because part of the brilliance of this story, the amazing drama of this story, is that the quilt that won was a scandal. So don't go anywhere. You know what I'm saying? The quilts will go on exactly. So this, you see a little bit of my, I scanned it from this and I, a little bit of a page issue on one side of it, but the quilt is in perfect shape. So this was, it's called Clipper Ship. We don't know who made it. It is maker unknown. 1933, possibly made in Michigan. Seagulls swirl, reminding viewers of the distances explorers have traveled. From Spain on a clipper ship across the Atlantic, on a plane, to America's West in covered wagons. All roads in 1993 led to Chicago's World's Fair, represented by the Sears Exhibition Hall. Look down here, seagulls. Mm-hmm, probably. Look, the Sears Exhibition Hall. At the bottom, we saw it. Remember, I showed you the picture so that you would be prepared. That's the exhibition hall. They incorporated the actual buildings. You know, many of the quilts incorporated many of the buildings of the fair into their quilt. These birds, yeah, the seagulls, yeah, exactly. Totally seagulls. And this wonderful embroidery work, you know, these looping, brilliant line work on the side, you know, and those, that ribbon. I think the ribbon is just sublime the way it is. Don't you think? And the blue and the gold. I love this quilt. I think it's amazing. I can't believe it's real. I love it so much. I love it so much. I do. It's so good. The composition, the ship in the middle. It kind of looks like the World War I Museum. Interesting. Yes, M. Hicks. Listen, Kenny. Kenny's wondering if his grandmother would have entered the contest. He says, I know she was a quilter and was married in 33. Kenny, is your grandmother still with us? Or, you know, is your mom or your dad, you know, able to tell you, you know, give you information like this? Because there are, think about it, 24,000 quilts were entered in to the contest. Now, I went to the Quilt Index. The Quilt Index has some really great quilts. So go to the Quilt Index, quiltindex.org. Search Century of Progress, you'll find a bunch of quilts. One of them is gonna, from the Quilt Index, is one I'm gonna show you because I love it so much. Oh, there's so many good ones. Okay, that's one. Okay, here. This one. So this one, we do not have a fancy picture of. This one is off the charts awesome. The ribbon is fantastic. Look at the shading. Exactly, Kelly. I mean, it's just perfect. The coloring was perfect on the ribbon. Okay. Here is this, what this is. So this picture is why we love the Quilt Index. We love the Quilt Index for many reasons, but this is in the Quilt Index. This quilt was by Zeta Chapman. So obviously someone has found, you know, somebody found this quilt or had this quilt and someone is like, you have to get this quilt documented. And the Quilt Index record for this quilt, and I'll put the name of the maker here in the chat so you can look it up on the Quilt Index if you like. Zeta Chapman made this quilt and it's called Folk Renditions. Folk Renditions of a Century of Progress. That was the record that was in the record, Century of Progress. Here's what was said. Now, I mean, just, it's bananas. I love it so much. I mean, we say around here, keep quilts weird. We're not kidding. We are not kidding. Okay, Kenny, okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, the Sears family. Mm-hmm. Yes, we do, Kelly. I'm going to show you the winning quilt in just a second. It's very crazy what happened. Okay. When Sears proposed making original quilts in the theme Century of Progress, some quilters and their spouses went scurrying off to libraries. Others tapped into their own reservoir of ideas. These examples I have called folk renditions of A Century of Progress. Okay, so this is Mary Kay Waldvogel writing about this quilt. Because she's the expert. Mary Kay Waldvogel is like totally the expert on these quilts. Barbara Brackman too, but Mary Kay, it's really her jam. Like she's the definitive voice on these things. Look at this. Meet Zeta Chapman, who created a quilt like none other at the time. At least none have been found. It might remind you of quilts by art quilter Susan Shee or quilt historian artist Teddy Pruitt. Interesting. It includes the Lord's Prayer, a silhouette of the state of Illinois. I saw that. I think it's up in the corner. And an embroidered account of an assassination attempt on Franklin Roosevelt in the months prior to the contest deadline. Are you kidding me? Wow. Really? Is there like a gun on this quilt? Wow. That's wild. 100 years old. Welcome to Chicago. I mean, this one. I love it so much. I can't look. I cannot tell a lie. God, what else does it say? Where is this assassination? This wheel. I mean, I don't know. It's amazing. It's out of this world. It's outrageous. I love it. I don't know where the assassination attempt is, but I do see something about the Chicago fire. Of course, there's the lady, Molly. O'Flanagan and her cow? No. Yes, the woman and her cow, right? It's a myth. It's a myth about the Chicago fire being started by... Whose cow was it? I can't remember. Anyway. Jade Ansir, I learned in Boston that a lot of these quilts, when found, still have their Century of Progress labels. Yes, and a new one occasionally turns up in somebody's attic. That's what I was trying to get at before this quilt stopped me in my tracks. 24,000 quilts. So there are so many out there, so many that have been lost, but there are so many that are out there. Keep your eyes open. I mean, you just, yeah, and like ask family, you know, do we have anything like this? Some of the quilts that I saw in the quilt index record were not, you know, crazy exciting. You know, some were just kind of pieced and they were just kind of doing their thing. But some of them, you know, I mean, they're like this. They're just crazy. This one. This is one of my favorites. I love this one. Is it the most, you know, is it like the last one we saw by Zeta? No. Is there something about it that I cannot resist? Yes. I think it's because, this is wild, but I'm going to say it anyway. Is there a list of all the entrants? Gordon Bernard. Very good question. There has to be. Mrs. O'Leary's cow. L. Riggs. You've got it. That's right. I love this quilt because it's so simple. Let me take it back really quick once more. It's so simple, okay? Composition-wise. But this might sound weird, but I'm going for it. The white applique that's happening here is so fine and so intricate and specific and like fancy that it reminds me of like lingerie. I know it's crazy, but if you look at, let me just get an example, okay? Like there's, well, okay, look at this coach. This is kind of, it's sexy. I'm sorry. This is like a sexy Model T or whatever it is. I mean, there's like this, there's a kind of French like atelier vibe that I'm getting from this. Just this very intense, like tiny work. It just seems so expensive, you know, like the way that the detail is and the tiny little stitches sort of, well, I mean, the tiny, tiny stitches on the applique stuff, but then there's these visible stitches in the background, which is sort of, I don't know, it feels like almost like basting stitches for clothing. I'm not sure. It's a visceral thing. What can you say about art? What can you, you know, express about, you know, articulate? why you feel the way you feel about a certain thing, but there's just something sort of lacy to it, perhaps, and something very, I don't know, recycled under things. Yeah, yeah. It feels like underwear in the best possible way. I don't know. That's what I feel. That's what I see. I mean, look at this. Come on now. You got to see what I'm talking about. Like the prettiest like corset you've ever seen. You know what I'm saying? Isabelline. What is it? Isabelline is. Oh, okay. Thank you. You get it. Of course you do. Of course you get it. Because you are my people. M. Sujan tuned in late, and I love the new plan, and I adore the quilt you just showed. Yes, M. Sujan. Yes. It's smartly done. Yes, Susan, it's smartly done. And it looks like a quilter took a white petticoat apart to make this quilt. Thank you. Exactly. It's the contrast between long and short. Ooh, you're good. Ooh, you're good. Sheer. Yes, sheer. There's a sheerness. Isabelline is a color. I'm in love with that color. I don't even know what it is. Victorian bloomers. Yes. Okay. I'm among friends. You understand what I'm talking about. I mean, look at this. Then we got to move on. But look at this. You know, that's maybe she used Batiste. There is something that material is not. It's not normal. You can tell there's something different going on. Okay. One more quilt, and then I will show you the winning quilt. I should totally, totally show you this one. Oh, beautiful, huh? Beautiful. This one, to send us off and to make you angry, because the truth is, one of the reasons this is so exciting is because it, like I said, it was a scandal about the winning quilt, and it will make you very, very upset. It will. It just will. But then we'll be okay because we're together. Okay. So this quilt was made by Lily Bell Schaefer Carpenter from Pennsylvania. This is an exact duplicate of the quilt that won first prize in the Philadelphia Regional Contest and was shown at the World's Fair. So this is a duplicate. It's from this book. So maybe the original quilt was lost, but this is exactly what it looked like, and it's owned by her son. Wait, hold on. I've got a detail. It's called the Rising Sun. And look at the piecing, huh? Isn't that something? It's really, really, really something. Look at the edges here. Gosh, that's pretty. You know, and this to me, I don't know why I just thought of this, but like, it looks like a theater set. Like if any of you are set designers or something, or maybe you set design for like a dance performance, wouldn't this just be an amazing like backdrop for a dance performance? I'm getting really like out there, but even like this, look at this, you know, can't you just see like little dancers dancing around? Wee, 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 wee. You know? We come here for inspiration. We look at quilts, but that's where it starts. And then it just goes from there. So anyway, that's pretty nice. And there's this really neat little ad. Whoop. Picture this beautiful quilt on your own bed. 1/4 of the quilt is illustrated. Full size measures 84 by 84. So yeah, you could order a kit. Or the Rising Sun pattern. It says, all of the material needed for the top and border ready stamped on 4 shades of sateen. Wow, cool. Or you can get it on gingham. Or you can get it on vat dyed Cleona cloth. So sateen was the pricey, was the premium fabric. Very interesting. Yeah, interesting, Lily. I like it, she says, as a quarter of the quilt. Yeah, that's it. It's very cool. It's very modern, exactly. Okay, you ready? You want to see the winning quilt? You want to see who won? You ready for this? The national prize winner? Okay, here's the announcement. Okay. Is the quilt pretty? Of course. Does it involve the century of progress? Theme at all? No, it does not. Is there cool writing on it? No, there isn't. Is there a building on it? No, there's not. What's the deal? Why did this win first prize? Well, here, I'm just going to tell you. You can read all about it. This is what I know. The woman who made this quilt, her name was Margaret Caden, C-A-D-E-N. And Margaret Caden was a wealthy lady. In her picture in the paper, well, I just showed it to you. She's like wearing pearls. So that's Margaret Caden. Sorry, Margaret. She won, and part of the big hullabaloo, let me get to that part in the book, was that it was sort of found out that she didn't make it. She didn't make her quilt, okay? She had other people, sorry, who made it for her. Now, you can read all about this this thing in the book Patchwork Souvenirs. But here's a little bit of it. Ann M. Caden ran a shop in downtown Lexington, Kentucky. She was running this shop with her sisters. Sorry, I've lost the thing. Okay. So the scandal is that she hired people to make this quilt for her. It's a great quilt, Molly, but yeah. Don't you know who I am? But she didn't make it, and she hired women to make it for her, and she didn't mention that when she submitted her quilt. One of the reasons that the quilt was so got so much attention is because what you can't tell in this picture is that there was stuffed work. Like there's like really beautiful like stuffed work going on, and I guess that just really impressed the judges. But it's not cool, because the whole idea why people were so inventive was because there was this extra prize money, and it was like this the whole thing, you know, Century of Progress and you know the transportation and you know agriculture and all, you know, all the things we've just seen. That was so exciting, and that's what they said, you know. It's like you said it was important to incorporate the theme, and Margaret Caden, you know, didn't need the money, sort of, you know, it's like that she was already, she had this shop and she was this successful person. And so all of these people who were desperate, you know, to win the money and to change their lives and the lives of their families, you know, they didn't get it, you know, they didn't win. And some of the people whose quilts you've seen, you know, wrote letters. Ida Stowe, who made that wonderful spaceshipy, you know, Rod Sterling quilt that we saw. She wrote a stern note. Kelly Naher, Trapunto, indeed. I mean, yeah. In Italy, it's called Trapunto. In France, it's called Bouti. You know, but yes, stuffed work. Yeah. I don't know if it's corded or whatever. Anyway, there's more to read about it. But yes, you're right. So, you know, it was like, yeah, exactly, Word and Bernard. So some people were really, really upset. And so Eleanor Roosevelt got the quilt. And she was supposed to write a letter to the winner. That was like part of the whole thing. But apparently she did not write a letter, because she got wind of like what had happened. And she was like, I don't think so. So there's, you know, and it came out that this had was not the way... you know, it was supposed to be done. You're supposed to make your own quilt. Like that was, those were the rules, is that you had to be an original design and all this. So there are more details about it, but that's sort of the gist, you know, here at the end of the program, is that the Century of Progress ended with this scandal. And Mountain Mist, by the way, reproduced this pattern. And it just, you know, it's a very traditional quilt, and it's very beautiful, and it won the grand prize. And so the Century of Progress, you know, time, like I started saying at the beginning of the show, is such an extraordinary moment in quilt history, because not only did so many people get involved. There was all this creativity. There was all of this innovation. And then there was this scandal. And to me, I actually think, let me get something back up here. I actually think, this is just me speculating and kind of going off on a flight of fancy. this is just pretty. The quilting is where she's got all the themes going on here in this quilt. I pay tribute to my flag and the country for which it stands. You know, this is in the quilting there. What I think is, like, you know, after this moment, after the Depression, we go into World War II. So there's a lot of things happening, but like quilts get a lot more standard looking in a lot of ways. Like the kit quilt, sort of, there's the rise of the kit quilt. It had already been happening, but then there's like this, wow, I look like I'm running for office. You know, the kit quilt comes into things, and there's many things happening, but like all this innovation, all of this creativity, and this just, yeah, these iconoclastic quilts. And what wins the big prize? A traditional quilt. This was a national contest. It was like all the kids were doing it, you know? It was like the dance craze that swept the nation. And what wins is this, so it's like, okay, that's what they want. You know, that's what people want. That's what the judges want. And I feel like, is it possible that that had some kind of effect on the way people were going to make their next quilt? I don't know. But you did enter a time of some fairly, you know, let me zoom out a little bit, fairly, I don't know. Stayed a little bit more staid in the quilt designs after this. So there you have it. You have learned many things. Yes, Kenny, yes. Do it. Margaret killed the art quilt. Oh, that's so good. I love it. She gets a honk too. Margaret killed the art quilt. Blame Margaret Caden. I love that. Everybody, you are the best. You're officially the best. We learned about the Crazy City quilt. C. Winnie, huge, big time. Tonight, your quilt nerd meter went way up, like way up, because now you know Crazy City, and now you know the Century of Progress, and we may have a caper on our hands in terms of the Elizabeth, this thing. Maybe not, but it was interesting, wasn't it? I love you very much, and everybody understands this change to the show is going to be awesome. Like, it'll grow our community, I believe. So if you just tuned in, we're doing two shows a week, Tuesday and Saturday. Tuesday night and Saturday night. Oh, and I'm so glad I remembered this. I miss my UK friends. And I think, so as I go forward, you know, doing a daytime thing, some daytime thing sometimes, I want to do that because I've totally lost the live audience that was in the UK while I was there because it's 2 a.m. there or something right now, you know? So I know that, and I've been thinking about it, you know? So we love you and appreciate you, Mary. Thank you for another wonderful show. It is my absolute pleasure. And I'm going to have this rosé. That's what I'm going to do. Well, you're a real treasure too. God bless you. Oh, I just love you. Oh, I just love you so much. Oh my God, I'm going to cry. Oh my God. Okay. When I see you on Saturday night, I will have jazz during the intro quilt and we'll go from there. Okay. Bye, you guys. Love you. Thank you so much. Bye.